So good afternoon, everybody. Now, just now we have seen the modern technology buses, high-tech buses. But again, one of the important question is how to maintain these buses. What infrastructure is required to maintain and operate these buses? This is very, very important. We can just see the number of buses, technology of buses, but how to maintain that? So in brief, I will cover what are the essential requirements, technological requirements for maintenance of buses. Now, very brief about this company, MP Group, what exactly we do. We are into facility management, we are into city bus operations, we are into employee transport, buses and cabs, we are into manpower leasing, we are into logistic support, we are into manufacturing, we are into education, and we are into HDM business support also. As far as education is concerned, we have a few skill development centers and we intend to develop these technical peoples required for maintenance of buses. This is one of our target now. We started with around 2 buses in year 1997. Now we have a fleet of around 550 buses of our own. We have a large number of private contract buses also, but the fleet is 550 buses for our own. We have a manpower of around 30,000 people. We have pan-India presence. We have presence in Noida. We have presence in Delhi. We have presence in Nasik, Mumbai, Pune, Goa. Southern side, we have presence in Hyderabad, Bangalore, Chennai. And we tend to expand towards eastern and central part of India. Now coming to best practices in maintenance and operation of buses. Now we'll start with the maintenance of buses. When you talk about the maintenance of buses, there are certain key components. These components we'll discuss one to one. First, the infrastructure requirement. What is the infrastructure requirement? What exactly we require? Second is the depot design. What type of depot design is required when you talk about the best maintenance practices? Then the equipment requirement. Third is the manpower requirement. Bus maintenance schedules, stores and inventory management, and MIS. So these are the essential components when you talk about the best maintenance practices. So when we'll start with the infrastructure requirement, what exactly is required for maintaining buses? When you talk about the infrastructure requirement, what exactly is required? Land requirement, 5 acres for 100 buses. Inspection pit, 1 pit for 20 buses. Repair bays, 1 for 50 buses. So these figures, these are not ballpark figures, or they have been copied somewhere else. Lot of technology, lot of engineering, lot of automobile engineering has gone into it. It all depends upon the volume of work generated when you are talking about the best maintenance practices. The volume of work generated decides how many pits is required, what was the area is required. Then parking yard, hard standing ground. This is very, very important and number of cities are lacking this. Fueling shed, washing shed, engineering building, traffic building, and security post. So these are the essential components and we cannot compromise with any of the components if you want to have best maintenance practices. If you are going to compromise with any of these components, your maintenance and operation of the buses will be badly affected. Now depot layouts or depot designs. So what type of depot layout or what type of design should I have? There are 2 or 3 types of depot designs or depot layouts which are prevalent across the India. So I'm selecting these standard designs. So this is one of the designs. I will just show the flow of the buses over here. This is a typical design. You can call it as Britisher's design, which is prevalent in BST, CSTC. Few of the organizations are following this design. See the, this is the entry gate. See the cursor. This is the entry gate and the exit gate. The bus enters from over here. This is the fueling shed, where the fueling of the buses is carried out. Then this is the washing shed, where the washing of buses is carried out. And see this area. This is the maintenance area. So we have 13 pits over here, 4 repair bays, and this is the entire engineering section where it has electrical section, tire section, stores, and all the sections are located over here. And this is the traffic building where drivers, conductors do report on duty. There are restrooms, then the medical facility, canteen facility, everything is available over here. So the typical unique feature of this design, see, all the activities are concentrated to the periphery of the depot. See, all the activities are over here. And the entire central area is left open for parking of buses. So this, since there is no movement, no activity at the center of the depot, there is no hindrance for movement of the buses and the chances of accident or anything reverse is very less. So this is one of type of the design. This is another type of design which is prevalent in the southern parts of India, the southern cities. So this is the entry gate, bus enters from here. This is the traffic building where the drivers and conductors report on duty. So this is the washing shed. Fueling shed, where the buses are fueled. This is the washing shed. And one of the unique features is all the maintenance activity here in this case are located at the center of the depot. Here, these are 2 long pits. You see the long pits, blue color lines. Unlike in the earlier design, we had pit of length of around 12 meters length. But in this case, we have pits with 26 meters of length. So two buses can be parked in each pit. So there are two pits, four buses can be repaired and maintained on these two pits. We have these two repair bays also. And all the engineering sections, electrical section, tire section, battery, everything is located surrounding these pits. So one of the advantages of this depot, this type of structure is, since all the sections are located surrounding this pit, there is better control and flow of the buses also. Buses can enter from this direction, maintenance can be carried out on these pits, and buses can move out from this direction. So in the earlier design, the buses are required to take in the reverse direction. Here, reversing is not required. Buses can flow freely. But one of the biggest disadvantage of this type of layout is, since the maintenance activity is located at the center of the depot, parking area gets reduced, and there are certain blind spots. You see, these are the blind spots, where if something happens in these spots, it gets unnoticed. So one more design is there, where this section is completely shifted to either this side or this side. But anyway, one thing you need to be understand that depot design or depot layout is not in only civil engineering or architectural function. Lot of mechanical engineering or automobile engineering goes into it. So what should be the design of pit? What should the depth of the pit? If I'm having a 900 floor height bus, the depth of the pit should be 1.4 meters. If I'm having a 400 mm floor height buses, the depth of the pit should be 1.65 meters. Then electrical section, where it should be located, what should be size. So lot of engineering goes into it, because we have seen some horrible depots. Recently we have visited few areas where the depot design or depot layout is such a horrible. So we cannot expect a good maintenance practices there, because depot design, depot construction involves a huge cost. So once you construct a depot which is not suitable for operation maintenance of buses, then it will be waste of money. Then next is area requirement. When I was talking about 5 acres for 100 buses, so why 5 acres are required? Why not 4 acres? Why not 3 acres? Why not 2 acres? So this gives the area requirement for area requirement. So parking of buses, 27% of area is required for parking of buses. Maneuvering of buses, 37% of area is required for maneuvering of buses. Open space, as per legal requirement, 3% of area is required. Infrastructure requirement, fueling shed, washing shed requires 7%. And engineering and traffic sections, I was talking about the pits, it requires around 25% of the area. So you see, 27% is only required for parking of buses, but to ensure the best maintenance practice, to ensure the buses are maintained to optimum level, 73% of area is required. So these are the standards. If you want to maintain that standard, this is must, and you cannot compromise with these standards. Then there are a lot of tenders nowadays being floated, where corporations or authorities do ask the operators to construct the depot. Land parcel is given to the operator, and operator is asked to construct a depot. If you see the contract period of 8 to 10 years, and you see the technology involved, see the engineering which goes into design of depots, you cannot expect an operator to construct such a depot. And see the life of a depot also. The depot life of depot is more than 50 years or 60 years. In BST, we have depots which are around 60 years or old. CSTCH has 50 years, DTC has 60, 72 years, much higher than the contract period of 8 to 10 years. So depot construction should be in the part of authority side, and maintenance and operation operator can handle it. So I'll give you two illustrations about it. This is one of the depot where authority has constructed the depot and authority is operating the buses. And this is where the land parcel is given to the operator, and operator is asked to operate and maintain the buses. See the difference. It's a rainy season, and how, see the difference. So you cannot expect the quality of maintenance in such cases. Next comes to the manpower requirement. How to calculate the manpower requirement? So how much staff is required for maintenance of buses? There is huge variation across the India. If you see large number of organizations, even in the category of staffs, there is huge variation. In few organizations, we have 60 categories of staff in maintenance of buses. In few organizations, there are only 7 to 8 categories of staff for maintenance of buses. So based on the data collected from various organizations, standard practices from India and across India, we have standardized something, how many categories are required and how to calculate that. If you see mechanical work, mechanics, how to calculate, how many mechanics we require? 14 mechanics for 11,000 kilometers of bus operation. If your daily operation is 11,000 kilometers, you require 14 mechanics. If you are 22,000, you require 28 mechanics. Then electricians, I require one electrician for 12 buses, body fitter one for 15 buses, then helpers, cleaners. So lot of engineering, lot of technology has gone into while calculating the manpower also. It's not a ballpark figure. It all depends on the volume of work generated. And when you want to have best maintenance practices, these are the figures which are required. We do not have any much standards now available in India. This has to be, these standards has to be generated by someone else. We have tried to do this. Next is equipment requirement. Even if you visit any private operator's depot or anyone use some STUs, there are hardly 7 to 8 equipments available in the depot. What exactly is the requirement of the equipments? So there are 54 numbers of equipments required when to have a standard maintenance practices. Then special equipments, when we want to have modernized the depot, then 14 numbers of equipments are required. And next part is MIS report. MIS report is the most neglected part when it comes to the maintenance of buses. So we have formulated certain 13 standard formats. If these formats are used in the depot, then we will get the entire picture of maintenance of buses. The next is the last in the maintenance schedule is the preventive maintenance schedule. What exactly the preventive maintenance schedule means? How many types of schedules are there? First is the daily maintenance schedule. So what exactly is required to be carried out in daily? There are certain activities which are required to be carried out on daily maintenance period. Then the periodic maintenance. This is very, very important. What means by the periodic maintenance? People normally follow 10-day cycle, 7-day cycle, 8-day cycle. We normally call it as decadely, weekly cycle, where after 10 days, vehicle is taken for preventive maintenance schedule. So how you are going to calculate this period? There are 4 ways to calculate this period. One is based on number of days. That is we normally call as 10-day cycle or 7-day cycle. But if you see, this is the most crude or rough method of calculating the period, because it doesn't correlate with the wear and tear. There are certain buses in a organization which run for 300 kilometers per day. There are certain buses which run for 200 kilometers. There are certain buses even run for 100 kilometers per day. So you are taking all the buses on a single day for attention of preventive maintenance schedule. So this doesn't correlate with the wear and tear of the buses. This is the most rough or crude form of calculating the period. But still, a lot of STUs or a lot of organizations are doing that. It's very surprising you have to move ahead with that if you want to have high technology of buses. Then based on number of hours of operation, this is more closer to variant year of buses, but again, record keeping is a bit difficult. Based on run kilometers, this is more precise because it is correlating with the variant year of the buses. But again, in the urban bus operations, where the buses are stuck up in traffic jam for hours together, where the movement of vehicle is very slow, speed of the vehicle is around 10 to 12 kilometers per hour. So wear and tear on the bus is there, but again, it is not reflecting on the run kilometers. So what is the ideal way for calculating this period in urban bus operation? The ideal way is based on the fuel consumption or diesel consumption. The moment you start the engine, it starts consuming the diesel, wear and tear starts, and the moment you stop the engine, wear and tear stops, and diesel consumption also stops. So period calculation based on the diesel consumption or fuel consumption is the most ideal way for calculating this period, because period is very, very important. If you are calculating this period, if you are calculating in the wrong way, then entire maintenance activity goes haywire. So period of calculation for urban city bus operation should be based on diesel consumption or fuel consumption. You can take the period as 500 liters of diesel consumption, 1,000 liters of diesel consumption. Bus can be attended after 500 or 1,000 liters of diesel consumption. This is the most ideal way. Then major docking schedule, then anticipation of the life of the unit and replacing the unit. This is one of the best practices being followed by a few organizations. It needs to be followed by all. Attention of FC renewal of buses. So this is the maintenance part. Now, very briefly about the traffic operations. So what are the key components in traffic operations? First is bus scheduling. Then schedule planning. If you see the schedule planning, across the India, we see a huge variation in schedule planning. If I have a fleet of 100 buses, for 100 buses, what percentage I should plan for schedules? Whether I should plan for 92% of buses, I should have 7% as float buses, whether I should plan for 93% or 95%. So there is huge variation. Few organizations do for 92%, few do for 93%. And there are even few organizations, they do schedule planning for only 75% of buses. So 25% of buses are kept as float. So this is one. And then it should be demand-based, precise calculation of running time. Revenue assurance time also is, revenue assurance team, previously it is called as checkers. It is also important. Monitoring of bus operations, traveling, training of driver, conductor, it's one of the important aspects. And how to calculate the manpower when you talk about the traffic operations. This is a very brief, drivers, conductors, controller, how to calculate that. Revenue assurance time, one for 40 trips. It is based on trips, not based on ETM staff and administrative staff. So at the last, concluding, so I was talking about the training of drivers and conductors is very, very important. So if the driver, if I ask you what is the difference between a driver conductor, you can easily say that driver drives the bus and conductor issues a ticket. If they are not going to do that, what will happen? Just read it. Got it? We'll get the ticket, up ticket directly. Thank you.